the nice thing about recurrent neural networks is that being another type of neural network, we can kind of, it inherits a lot of the same properties of ordinary neural networks and CoveNets that we've seen already, so we can kind of bootstrap our understanding of them from there and then talk about what they do differently. And the main thing they do differently is they have an internal state which actually changes over time. So as it accepts new inputs, it is able to adapt its, or it's able to change its state in such a way that we don't have, that we have different behavior over time. And this is distinct from all the kinds of neural networks we've seen so far, which are effectively static. So if you put some sort of an input into them, they will give you the same output regardless of when or how, how you've done it. And we're going to talk about exactly how that's done. The reason why we do this is because it allows us to operate over sequences of inputs. And in particular, it allows us to operate over sequences of inputs that are not fixed in some in length. So it really, really expands the range of possible applications. And when we get into the applications of this, you'll see exactly why you know, no machine learning class is complete without talking about them. Recurrent neural networks can mess with your head a little bit at first, and I don't expect, especially you know, for this kind of a short demo, for everyone to understand exactly how they work. But I'll kind of try to take the gist of them so people understand at least what they're capable of. Also, most people are probably have already kind of seen these in action, or at least a type of recurrent neural network, which you're going to talk about called LSTM. So if you've seen a lot of the like text prediction or machines that generate text in the style of some other, in the style of some author or something like that, that's being done by recurrent neural networks. So we're gonna see that in just a few minutes. So in order to build up our understanding of these, I want to quickly review the neural networks that we've seen so far, and in particular focus on the things about them that they have in common with recurrent neural networks. So we'll do a really quick review of neural networks in general. What's going on here? There we go. So just recall, like, a neural network is basically something like this. It's a data structure that has a whole bunch of inputs, or neurons, what we call them, or nodes, that are arranged sequentially in a series of layers. And in the first layer, it accepts some sort of a fixed size input, and then those values propagate through the network. They get multiplied by weights, and we've been talking about weights. And then finally, they end up in the last layer of the network, which is the output layer. And this is what we use to perform like classification or regression or association of different input sets to output sets or whatever you want to interpret it as. Usually, we do like prediction. And convolutional neural networks are just like this, except they have a few innovations, which I'm going to review also. But both these kinds of ordinary neural networks and CoveNets, we call them sometimes feed-forward neural networks, because all of the information sort of propagates from left to right, and it doesn't ever stay or go in circles or anything like that. And that makes them very sort of stable and easy to train in comparison, but they lack a certain flexibility that recurrent neural networks are going to give us. Recall when we look at, like, when we constrain our network to have one layer, and we look at a network which is trained on handwritten digits like these, the weights have some interpretation, so we can kind of like see templates of the classes emerging. And so we see the value of weights. They kind of give us some characterization of the data that we're interested in. CoveNets do this, right? So, and Kyle was mentioning these convolutional layers. What happens in them, and we've seen this, right? So I'm just going to fly through this. We have this set of filters, which we slide across the image, and then every subset of the image is multiplied by the filter. We take a dot product, right? And these are the activations from that. So we call them activations or responses or something like that. And you can see that they're kind of looking for like sympathetic. So the filter is looking for sympathetic patterns, and that's where we get these impressions. And we did this in more detail, but we know that the value of this is that it's able to sort of capture features regardless of where they occur in the image, and they are really good for building up a sort of compositional understanding of data, in particular images, but it can be used for other things as well. And then we have pooling layers. Kyle explained this, right? That's right back there. So those are just doing downsampling, basically. we have this demo. This is using OFXCCV, so I've used this a bunch of times. And we go through the network, right? And this is kind of similar to the network we just set up, but except this one is pre-built for us. And then the final fully connected layer is this, right? So or dense layer as we saw. And then that feeds into the classification layer. And the really nice thing that we understand about these is that these are, we've been calling them magic, right? Because basically they characterize the image in this sort of high-dimensional vector, which has many properties. And some of the ones that you saw that Kyle presented, and also like the T-SNE images that we looked at a few weeks back, you can see that these are very valuable, basically. And we also used it for transfer learning and so on, so different kinds of applications. Let me skip that. We also learned that we can visualize the weights, and we can also visualize, we can try to understand the activations a little better by looking to see which parts of the image were maximally activated by particular filters. And you can see, so they're like in intermediary layers, they're looking for these sort of high level concepts. So like this neuron right here is looking for car wheels, it appears. This is looking for dog faces and so on. And then we also looked at some experiments that you can do with occlusion. So you can understand a little bit about what pixels are contributing to the activations by doing these occlusion experiments. So for example, with this Pomeranian, if we cover its face, the classification of the Pomeranian being a Pomeranian goes down. And this has actually come into play a little later when we look at some of the ways of combining this with RNNs. We talked about deep dream and style transfer and different ways that you can use the activations to create interesting, like optimized images that have some properties that we like. So style transfer is one of them, and deep dream. And we talked about how StyleNet is done. T-SNE is what we've been talking a lot about today. So T-SNE, with respect to convolutional neural networks, we can feed in that last layer of activations and give ourselves some really nice visualizations in the process. So this is T-SNE combined with the gridding algorithm. I don't think Kyle actually showed any gridding examples. So this is what happens when you take the unordered 2D T-SNE and you assign them to a grid. And we get these like images that are very similar to each other. Like a bunch of whales will be right next to each other, right, and so on. So take everything that we've learned about feedforward neural networks, right? And this is like a multi-layer ordinary neural network, and this is a convolutional neural network. And I want you to squeeze all of that knowledge into this yellow box. Basically, this is really what we're looking at, right? So this is a feedforward neural network has the following properties. It accepts a vector input, which is fixed in size, and that's crucial that it's fixed in size, and that's actually a limitation that we want to try to get around. And it multiplies it by some weight matrix. And it does it in a series of layers, but effectively you have just a whole bunch of weights, right? So this is all a function of these weights. They don't change. And so then we get an output vector y, which corresponds to like a classification or regression or what have you. And we use the training process to optimize these weights. So we want the weights to be such that when we put in arbitrary vectors x and we expect it to have some vector y, it will do that with some reasonable accuracy, right? And again, y is also a fixed input size. So here it's 10, and the images have 784 pixels over here, and so on. So this is kind of, this is basically the most high-level view of a feedforward neural network that we can come up with. So recurrent neural networks are going to do this. So this is what we haven't seen before, this new thing that we'll call a hidden state. And in the recurrent neural network, this hidden state is a function of time. So every time we put in a new sample, the time counter goes up. And this hidden state changes. And then the value of y, the prediction that we make, is a function of h of t, which means that it's going to change also. So if we run this many times and we put in the same vector x, it's going to have a different response later. And the way this is set up, a little more explicitly, looks like this. And this is kind of the simplest way it can be done. We have this operation right here, like the h of t times w equals y, is kind of replacing this. So this is the last mapping. We have this hidden state, It gets multiplied by a bunch of weights, and we get a response. But h of t is a function of both the input and the previous hidden state. So this at the end, so we'll, like, if we do this in order, we'll pipe x in here, we'll calculate this hidden state, we'll calculate y, and then this will get shuttled over here and become h of, in, at the next time step, it will become the previous one. So h of t is constantly evolving as a function of all of the previous hidden states. And that's important because, well, we'll see kind of why that's important in this next slide. So let's just like run through a sequence of these, right? So we first put in x of 0. It goes through this hidden state, and we get a y of 0. And then at the next time step, we this is going in time now, left to right is time. We have a new input, and then h of 1 is a function of both the previous hidden state and the new input. And then we get a new output, right? And we can do this infinitely, basically, as many times as we want. It's the same operation over and over, so we can do this as many times as we want. And what's important is that it's not commutative, right? I think that's the word we use in math. So, like, you know, like multiplication is commutative because A times B equals B times A. But this is not, because every hidden state is a function of all of the other previous hidden states. And that's important because that's good, what's going to allow us to operate over sequences. Right. So, and let me actually go to the next slide. So let's look at, and this is the example that most people are probably familiar with, is training on text so that we can generate text that looks like it came from the text that we trained it on. Right. So suppose you have this text and it's just "Hello World." We can set it, we can set up our recurrent neural network in the following way, where we take "Hello World" in order. And we propagate them through the network, and we set the targets, right, the y vectors that we want to train on, to be the next character in the sequence. So h to e, e to l to l, l to o, and so on, right? And then we can train as normal, you know, consider these are all like samples, basically. And we want the weight vectors that we saw before, right, these three weight vectors, in the simplest case, to be such that these accurately predict the next character in the sequence. If we have that, we can sample text from this recurrent neural network once it's trained in the following way. We put in a, let's say we like seed it, we start with an initial character, like H, let's say we put in an H, and it will predict what it thinks the next character in that sequence should be, and it'll give us this big probability distribution over all of the characters. And then we can sample from that probability distribution. So we can like sample a character which is likely to occur. And then we take it, and then we just feed it back into the recurrent neural network and then predict another character based off of that. Sample from that and keep on repeating this process. So if you do that on large corpuses of text, it will begin to produce text that looks like it came from that corpus. Right? So for, oh, yes?
It's like this is like sequence feature detection. It's like, can I say it? Like, you know, you can get the features of this like hollow world sequence.
Well, you. The features in this case, like the features that the RNN is detecting, are going to be, they're a little more abstract than a Markov chain, because in a Markov chain it's very explicit. It's like the calculated statistics of word-to-word or character-to-character transition probabilities. And here we're using a neural network, so the relationship between in these predictions is basically very nonlinear and very deep, basically. It's a little hard to... But Markov chains can also be used to sample text. The limitation of Markov chains is that they have a very fixed memory. So if you're doing if your Markov chain is like trained on 4 grams or something, right? So like a sequence of 4 words, then it will never really, it has no idea what came before the last 4 words. And in RNNs, we actually see that it does. So that's kind of why these are much better for that. Yeah, exactly. I completely agree with that sentiment. I also cannot totally understand it. So to actually, now we're not going to look at this in detail because I actually don't really understand it personally. But these, the particular variety of RNNs that we've used, that we're using for this, is called an LSTM, which stands for long short-term memory. And it's a type of recurrent neural network, and we're going to use them. I'm going to refer to them interchangeably, more or less, because this is just a type of RNN, so everything we see applies. But it has these internal dynamics that make it particularly well suited for predicting things that have very long, potentially very long, like contexts or dependencies, and they have this sort of concept of internal memory that they use in a very sort of bizarre, strange way. I can point you to some reading material that might help you understand exactly what that means. So I'm just going to show you a few examples of this. So there's a really good blog post about recurrent neural networks by Andre Karpathy, who Kyle mentioned. And actually, a lot of his work will appear in this. He's done a lot of work with RNNs. So this is coming from that blog post. I'll share the link later. So this is sampling Shakespeare. And if you read it, you'll see, like, okay, King Lear, oh, if you were a feeble sight, the courtesy of your law, your sight and several breath will wear the gods with his heads. And so if you read it, you'll see long enough that it like sounds like Shakespeare. Maybe it doesn't make a ton of sense, but it's a machine composing in the style of Shakespeare. Can you raise your hand if you've seen these before? Because these have been, you know, like around ITP, I think a lot of people have seen these. Okay, so we can kind of go through these quickly. You can train it on all kinds of texts. So like if you train it on XML, and this is a good example to use, you see that it finishes the page tag. So there's a page tag in the beginning, and then it produces a page tag at the end. So this is what a Markov chain would definitely not do, because it won't remember that it put a page here. And you'll see that it's quite effective at actually closing all of these brackets. So it's quite good at that. There's a lot of really funny things you can do with it. So this is trained on Linux source code. And you see it makes if statements and for loops, and it makes its own weird comments and things like that. And it works remarkably well. It produces what looks like actual code. It's not going to compile. But it maybe comes pretty close. This is my favorite. I think they trained it on LaTeX. So LaTeX is this format for rendering math equations on computers, and it's just text. So they trained it on this big database of papers about algebraic topology, and it just started making fake math papers. And you see all these like weird equations. They're totally meaningless. But it looks like a very convincing sort of algebraic topology paper, I suppose. And it even makes its own figures, which is really funny. Recipes, this is really funny. So this is trained on like Epicurious or something. And you know, this is a Chinese meat of two. And then it's gonna list all the ingredients. So medium potatoes, chopped onions, sesame seeds, and tarragon. And I look at this and I think like, okay, this is like a curry, I think, right? But then when you start reading the instructions, it just starts using ingredients that are never even listed. Like prepare sour cream into egg coloring. Like what sour cream? There's no sour cream. And then when ice cream can be softened dumplings. So okay, this basically speaks for itself. Someone made a Twitter bot that's just speaking in the style of Donald Trump. And actually, this is just going all. This is very top shelf. Like it's just deep dreamed his entire face, and like we can read some of the things that it kind of spews out. I'm just gonna let you read that. Okay. Anyway, deep jump. Yeah. I trained it on my sent Gmails. So this is, and actually all my software is not working right now, but I trained it to, I took all the emails that I've ever sent and I fed them through an RNN and then started composing emails like I do, I suppose. And this is actually poorly trained, so it may not actually sound that good, but this is more or less how I send emails. I really like that it has fully formed URLs inside the email. See, this is like a link to /. Thrill simple bulb .html or something like that. You can train it on other languages. So this is War and Peace in Russian. You guys saw this, emojis, so text files that Kyle made. And really like anything that you can represent as text, this guy, Adam Gaitgay, I don't know if I'm saying his name right. He produced new Super Mario levels using an RNN, right? Because anything that can be represented as a sequence, like all these obstacles that you find in Mario, can be turned into, can be fed into an RNN. Okay, so here's where things get really neat. The great thing about recurrent neural networks is that you can sort of plug them into various architectures and do really neat things with them. So this is an example of this would be sequence to sequence. Now, we just did sequence to sequence, essentially, like predicting characters of sequence is an example of sequence to sequence. But we could, for example, set it up so that we feed in a sequence of characters, and then it goes through this hidden state, and then we don't actually care what comes out here, just initially. We feed in a sequence so that we condition the hidden state to be a certain way, and then we ask it to output a new sequence. So doing sequence to sequence, this can be used for what? Can anybody guess? You can use it for language translation, right? So if you feed in a sequence of English words, let's say, and you ask for the French translation, you would be able to translate into from English to French, and not necessarily with the same number of words, because we don't have that limitation, right? So like, this is just a joke, actually, if not using an RNN, so I don't know, Yoda language. But the nice thing about language translation is that it basically replaces this. So this is the way language translation is done by Google right now, which involves a lot of expert knowledge, like linguistical knowledge, where it will parse the English and turn it into one of these lexical trees, and then it will try to translate each part of it individually. And it's not very effective because it makes a lot of assumptions about languages that may not necessarily be true, and it's just more complicated in general. The promise of deep neural networks and recurrent neural networks is that we can just, if we have a big enough parallel text where we've already translated some English to French, we can feed it into a recurrent neural network and it will learn whatever internal data structures it needs in order to effectively translate. And it doesn't necessarily have to be done, you know, languages. It could be, like, I saw this a while ago. I was trying to find a link today, and I couldn't find it. Someone trained, like, Middle English to New English, or to Modern English. So you can translate, like, different kinds of anything that you can think of that can be represented as a parallel text can be trained to do translation in this fashion. You can also do, and now here's where things get really tricky. Suppose that we're interested in feeding some fixed input, so not a sequence, and then deriving a sequence from it. So like, for example, we might want to put an image into a recurrent neural network and then have it caption it, right? So we saw this earlier. We looked at the program that Kyle ran, the image captioning program. So that's an example of this. We give a recurrent neural network an image, and it will produce a sequence of in that case, it was words, not characters, that describes it. And I'm going to show you a little bit, like, basically how this works. And again, we're approaching this at a very high level. So if the details escape you, that's okay. They escape me for the most part anyway. So the way it would work is that we take a convolutional neural network, and we run the image through it, and then we take from it that last layer activations, right? So that really magic layer, the one that I keep calling magic, and we initially condition the recurrent neural network, the hidden state of it, from those activations. And then there's a start token. I haven't really talked about the tokens very much, but this kind of starts it in motion, and then it will begin to predict words until it reaches an end token, and then it knows to stop. So if the intuition behind this is that, you know, remember, these hidden states are such that they're trying to make, there's like in every region of this hidden state that we might be in, it might be more or less predisposed to creating certain kinds of sequences of words. If we, by feeding in an image initially and conditioning it initially on that image, we're kind of like finding the space of this recurrent neural network's hidden state, which will be more likely to sample words that describe that image, if that makes any sense. I'm gonna kind of skip this. This can be combined with some things about like localization, which is figuring out which these words, where they actually, like what subset of the image the words correspond to. So that's kind of a nice feature that is in research, in undergoing research right now. So these are just some examples of that. So like man in the black shirt is playing a guitar, construction worker in orange safety vest is working on the road. And these, I suspect, are cherry-picked, so they're like really good examples. But you can see that it's quite effective. And for me, it's still, it's really hard to believe that this kind of a data structure that we set up is able to do this so effectively using the data that it has. I should mention also, these are trained on an image data set called Microsoft COCO, which is like 100,000 images that people have painstakingly transcribed and described using, I think, Mechanical Turk or something. Or no, Microsoft. I don't know how Microsoft developed their data set, but you need a big training set. So normally when we do these experiments, because it's very difficult to arrange such a huge training set, we're often just downloading pre-existing models that different institutions have created and shared with us. Let me just check how I'm doing at time. Oh yeah, so you've seen this. This guy in a goatee, I don't know if you recognize him. I don't know who this is. I just call him goatee guy. this is the video that he initially did this in. Exactly, yeah. Okay, so let's move on just because. Let me see how we're doing. 5:42, okay, 10 minutes, great. You can also, this is the next level of this. And actually, I just want to point out that the thing that we're looking at right now, the software for it was released just yesterday. So that's how up-to-date this class is. We're getting a new week's worth of material every week we have the class. Like, if you're teaching 19th century English literature, you don't have to deal with that problem, right? But we have to, yeah. So the class is basically obsolete because we have all this new stuff. And what it's doing is it's captioning, it's doing full descriptions of subsets of the image. And you can see they're quite good, right? So like banana slices in here, and then this is a cup of fruit, this is a bottle of water, and so on. And that's kind of how this is, and it's called dense captioning. Again, this is by the group at Stanford, so that's Karpathy, Justin Johnson, and Fei-Fei Li doing this kind of stuff. And I included this even though I don't really understand. There's like, it's combining this model that we just looked at, this captioning, with this localization layer, which kind of proposes subsets of the image that it thinks might have some semantic meaning. And then it kind of tries to, in training, optimize both at the same time. So like trying to condition this LSTM to predict words, which are coming from these proposed subsets. And this is at a very abstract level how it works. This is from a recent paper also, so you can do this kind of like what they call semantic object parsing, where they do this segmentation, but they also locate the different parts of the segments, which is again using convolutional neural networks and LSTMs together. This one is generating handwriting, so it kind of, it's like a pen that's moving around and generating, so these are all fake. Basically. So you can see LSTMs have a lot of different applications across a lot of different domains, right? So this is, I think, the last kind of architecture that I want to show, which is now doing the reverse of what we just saw. We input a sequence and then predict a single fixed output. So what would this be useful for? Well, this could be useful for anything, right? So we can like feed in, let's say, audio features and determine the genre of that. Because genre could be represented by a vector, and audio features coming in time can be coming in like this, or this can be used for sentiment analysis. So if we get a sequence of words and we want to know how happy or sad it is, we can condition an RNN in this fashion if we have enough training samples to do it. And actually, a really awesome application of this is doing. So we were just looking at captioning images. You can also, using an architecture like this, you can generate images from captions. So the complete reverse process, and these are really funny. They're quite small and they're kind of dinky, but this is a stop sign. A stop sign is flying in blue skies. A herd of elephants flying in the blue skies. A toilet seat sits open in the grass field. So this is really cool. And it looks kind of, you know, dinky and small right now, but this stuff is always getting better. And I don't even think, you know, even 1 or 2 years ago that anyone had demonstrated something like this. So it's pretty exciting to see this. And it really hints to like a more general property that we need to be talking about, which is that we're building these, you see now we're combining CoVNets and recurrent neural networks together. And we're creating these very large architectures that we can kind of plug different elements into, and it works as this sort of ensemble of systems which can be constantly reinforcing the larger system. So like we can have, because this is doing the opposite of what we saw, they can potentially be helping each other, so providing data for each other. And this is really sort of like how the human sensory system works too, right? So like we have a whole bunch of sensory organs and they're all kind of imperfect, but working together, they can inform us about like different obstacles that are coming. And so, you know, if our vision is blocked suddenly, we don't just like go blind, right? We've seen what we just saw from before. And you can kind of think of that in the fashion of like a recurrent neural network. So we're very good at using our sensory systems to avoid obstacles and like navigate our way through streets and get sent back in time to kill John Connor and so on, like all this kind of stuff. This is also another example where the inputs and the outputs are actually fixed, but they're processed sequentially. So this was a paper where they demonstrated how to read house numbers, which are not necessarily like oriented left to right. You know, they might be diagonal or up down. And they train a recurrent neural network to move a convolutional neural network around this image and process it in a certain order in order to read these images. So that's a really cool application and then this is the opposite. This is actually generating house numbers. And it's doing it within this sort of red subset. So it's drawing them in order. This is a really well-known paper called Draw. This system that they made basically is operating on this canvas over time. So it's quite interesting for that. You can think this is another thing. You can have sequence to sequence, but there's a correspondence between each of the... So like it's not just you input a sequence and then output a sequence, but... there's a correspondence between the input and the output. Nevertheless, they are sequences. So for example, this could be useful for like video classification where you might want to use information from previous video frames to guide whatever you're trying to process in this video. So if you're trying to do like, for example, tracking a blob over time or like tracking an object, you would probably want to use an architecture like this. Okay, so that's the end of the slides. I just want to say a few quick things before we stop. I'm going to do this offline. I'll generate like a tutorial on how to use terminal.com. And I have an instance which is doing style transfer using an implementation of style transfer. And it has a new version of char-rnn. So you can do both style transfer and generating sequences of text from it, from char-rnn. The downside is right now, for some reason, the GPU isn't working on this instance. So that doesn't mean that you can't do it. It just means that it takes a really long time, which is quite annoying. So I'm going to try to fix that if I can. If not, then you can still use it. You'll just have to maybe like wait a little longer. We have lots of credit built up, and I'm going to give all of you, basically they have a way of allocating accounts to each student. So you guys will be able to make these. It's really, the tools themselves are really simple. Like it's gonna be like a 5-minute tutorial. You just log in, and it's a command line tool where you upload an image, and then you specify where that image is and which image you wanna use as a style, and then it will generate these awesome neural style images for you. So just look out for that. I'm going to email you guys about that. Wow, I actually made it to 5:50, not bad. I'll email you guys again about office hours. I think we're going to do something similar to what we did the last week and this week. I'll be in on like a Tuesday probably. I haven't met with everyone yet, so you guys come find me during the office hours, tell me what you want to do for projects. Next week is our last lecture week, and then week 7 is just going to be you guys making presentations. So I'm going to kind of try to finish, tie up some loose ends. So start thinking about what you want to do for that week. And that's all. So see you next week. Thanks, guys. Yes. This is an addendum to the last lecture video notes for machine learning for artists at ITP. Here I'm going to take you through the procedure of launching a terminal.com instance of a virtual machine that has all of the deep learning software that we need pre-installed. And we're going to look and see how to run two repositories in particular. One is torch-rnn, which is by Justin Johnson, and updating Andre Karpathy's earlier work, char-rnn. This will let us use LSTMs to generate text. And the other one is neural style, which is also by Justin Johnson, and that is a script for doing style transfer. I'm going to show you how to do those in terminal.com. This will be useful for you in other environments as well. So you can also, if you manage to get the software installed on your local machine, all of this can apply equally well. I'm just using Terminal because it's easy to get started with. If you're one of the ITP students, I'm going to share the login credentials with you separately to log into this account. Otherwise, you can, if you want to use Terminal, you can create your own account and find the snap that I'm going to load. So if you go to My Snaps, once you're logged into this account, and if you're not logged into this account, you can find this publicly listed. So if you just search for ML4A, it should in the Snaps terminal, it should come up. So a terminal snap is like a saved machine. So it has all of the software that we need pre-installed. And I'm going to take you through the procedure of launching one of these. When you do launch it, I just do one thing. Put your name, if you're part of the ITP students course, just make sure you put your name at the end of it so we can differentiate among the different ones that are listed under this account. So I'm going to put my name here. And the type of account, just use an X large. And that's the one that I've been testing with, is a CPU instance. Don't use GPU right now because the GPU is not configured properly, so it's just a waste of credit. It's the most expensive type. And one thing I'd also like for you to do is to click the auto pause option. So then when your machine is idle, auto pause will automatically pause it, so it doesn't just waste credit. Okay, so when you click start, it's going to create a terminal, and I'm going to take you through the interface in just a moment. What this will do is launch an interface inside the browser to this machine, which is being hosted by terminal.com. And if we see here on the left, there's a file explorer, okay, that starts here. And let's just go into the root folder to see the contents of this. And this is the one we're going to work inside, which is ML4A. So this is kind of has the two repositories that we're going to look at. This is a text editor. For now, you're not really going to need to use it, so I'm just going to make it a little smaller. And then this is the terminal. And this is a generic Unix terminal, so all commands are apply. So ls, for example, will list the contents of the home directory that you're in. Cd will switch directories, and I'm going to go ahead and switch into ml4a and see the contents of this directory. And first we're going to start with torch-rnn, so I'm going to go ahead and switch to that. And if I go in the file explorer, we'll see all of the contents of torch-rnn. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the process of first training a text, and then we're going to sample from that text. So if you, the first thing we want to do maybe, and this will kind of be useful, is to look at the README. And actually a better thing to do would be to just look at, if we simply search torch-rnn and go to the GitHub page, we can read the README here. And this just describes everything that we need to get going with it. You can skip the installation because we've already installed it. So none of this is, if you do want to install it on your own machine, these are the instructions for doing so. There's some detailed instructions for setting it up on a Mac, which you may find useful if you'd like to do it that way. Okay, so the first thing we need to do is we need to get a text. And there's a couple that I've loaded here for you. It comes with Tiny Shakespeare. And there's also a Jack Kerouac on the road. I'm also going to find the whole text of the Bible, which is one of the texts that I've been experimenting with. This is nice to use because it's quite large, so it's a really good text to train on. In general, you really need to have something like at least 100,000 characters in the training text for this to be useful. If your text is much smaller, there are ways for us to sort of pre-train on a bigger model and then to kind of switch in the smaller text at the end to get more high-level characteristics of that text. This is called transfer learning, and we've seen this in practice with images. If you intend to use a small text, then we'll look into ways of doing that in just a bit. I want to first send this to Terminal, and you can upload it simply. You can either click Upload Files, or you can just actually drag this right into here. Okay, so that's going to upload. It's a couple megabytes. And if we go back to the terminal, we'll see, and we go into the data folder, we'll see that we have this input.txt, which is now the Bible. I'm just going to rename it to Bible, which is what it is. I think it's the Old Testament. Okay, so now we have this Bible text. And the first thing we have to do is run this pre-processing script. And what the pre-processing script does is it does a couple things. So it extracts the tokens that we're working with. So that's the individual characters that exists. And it also generates one of these H5 files. This H5 file is a file format that is kind of used for loading data sequentially in batches. And this is kind of useful for if you're working with large data sets and you can't load all of it into RAM at once, this will let us kind of effectively move it into RAM one batch at a time. And we have to generate one of these, and there's a script to do so. Under the scripts folder, if we look at the README, the instructions are here. So basically you run this script pre-process, you supply an argument to what your input file is, and for us that's going to be bible.txt, and then you just specify what you want to call it. Okay, so I'm just going to go back into the terminal, and because I'm going to move back to the torch-rnn directory. You have to run this from better from here, I think, from the root directory of torch-rnn. So it's a Python script, so we run Python, and that script is inside the scripts folder. So if I just write scripts, we can use tab to autocomplete. Okay, so scripts / preprocess. And just looking at the arguments again, and actually this is just in general, you can get most of the important arguments from the README. So it needs an input text. So input text. And that's going to come from our data folder, and it's going to be called bible.txt. And then it tells us to say what the H5 file is, so output H5. And we'll just keep it in the same folder, so we'll just call that bible.h5. And then also the JSON file, which contains the actual tokens that are used, or that are discovered by the preprocessing step. We can just call that bible.json. So we'll run this, and this will generate all of the data, and we can see that once it's done, we have this bible.h5 file, which is our data in the H5 format, and we have this JSON file. So we're going to be using these now to train. The next thing I'm going to do is show you how to train. Now, the first, just to as a review, and you can see this in the lecture notes that are associated with this video, or the previous part of this video. We're going to train a character-level recurrent neural network on the text of the Bible, in this case. And of course, you can use whatever corpora that you would like. And this is going to take a really long time. In particular, it's going to take a long time because we're running it on the CPU. For torch-rnn and LSTMs, the speed up with GPU is not very large. It's much more of a speed up with convolutional neural networks and some of the image processing applications that we'll look at, including neural style. But here it's going to be relatively manageable training time. So again, if we just go back to the README, this will show us how to train the model, and it's a pretty simple script. We just call this is train.lua. This is a Lua file. This is a programming language called Lua. And th is calling torch, which is a framework for deep learning that's written for Lua. And that's kind of what this repository is using. And you can see that it accepts a couple arguments. We have to give it the path to our H5 file and our JSON file. And then there's a whole bunch of arguments that we can look at, and actually the best way of doing so is to simply actually go th train.lua, and then if you just supply this help argument, It's going to show us all of the different arguments that we can supply. Okay, so and the ones here at the top, so you can see that it uses this tiny Shakespeare corpus as a default. We're gonna give it the path to our Bible file. Okay, so and then I'll talk about what these some of these other parameters do. For the most part, you can ignore them, but I'm going to show a little bit about what they do. Okay, so th.train.lua, and then our input h5 is going to be coming from the data folder again, and it's bible.h5, and our input json is going to be bible.json, and then we can look at the rest of these arguments. So the batch size controls these, so when we're training, we are loading batches of data, and in the default is 50 at a time. For you could probably more or less leave this alone. If you have more memory, you might wish to increase this. But for our purposes, we're just going to leave it at the default. The sequence length is related to the also again in the training process where we are computing back propagation over a sequence of characters in this case, and this is the sequence length. This one is a little trickier to you might want to basically experiment with this. There's not some good rules of thumb for what tends to work well, but I'm just going to leave it at the default. One other parameter that's worth looking into is the RNN size. So this controls the number of cells inside each layer of the recurrent neural network, and this controls the number of layers. You may wish to make your recurrent neural network a bit more complex by having, say, even 256 or 512 cells inside each neuron. And in principle, this should make the model somewhat better or more accurate, although it doesn't always do, the difference is not always large. It's definitely going to increase the amount of time it takes to train. So this is something that you want to take into account as you're setting these. For now, I'm just going to leave it at the default, and you can experiment with this as you wish. And the other thing is there's this parameter called checkpoint name. What checkpoint name is as the network is training, every so often it will save the trained model at that point. So we're going to get a series of trained models. And in the beginning, they'll be trained on just after a few epochs or iterations. And I'll talk about what those mean in just a moment. And so we can actually use these to look and see how the recurrent neural network is evolving. And once we get to sampling, I'm going to show you exactly what it does. You can leave this at the default if you'd like, but I'm actually going to change it to CV Bible. And the reason is because if you train different texts, then you may want to use different names so as to prevent overwriting different checkpoints. So this will kind of give us a sense of what the checkpoints are actually corresponding to. And then the last thing that you want to look at, one other parameter actually, this checkpoint every is how many batches of data before running the checkpoint. So I'm just going to leave it at 1,000. So this is going to basically for every 1,000 batches, it's going to save the trained model at that point. And then the last thing I want to do, and this you have to do because otherwise it's not going to run, is GPU -1. What this is doing is it's telling Torch to not use the GPU because it's not available anyway, so it's not going to run. If you forget to do this, this will actually just give you an error, so you just have to make sure to turn this off. So I'm going to click Enter, and it's going to start training. If I've done everything right, it looks like I did something wrong. CV Bible. Oh, I forgot to actually say the argument name. Okay, so checkpoint name. Okay, so now I go ahead and run this, and now it's running in CPU mode and it's beginning to train. So I'm just going to describe what all of this means. So this epics, it's, oh, shit, I'm going to stop this real quick. I forgot. One other thing is the number of epics. So I'm going to add that as an argument. You'll see here one of the arguments we can use is max epics. This is what an epic is it's a complete run-through of the entire training set. So 50 epics means that we're going to train it. We're going to comb through the sequence of characters 50 times. And I'm actually going to make this a little bit bigger. I'm just going to make this, let's use 200. So this is going to train 200 epics. It's going to take a long time, a number of hours. And I'm going to go ahead and start that right now. Okay, so this is running. So again, we're looking to see that it says epic 1.01 out of 200. So it's giving us sort of a decimal representation of the epic. So this is the first epic out of 200. We're about 2% of the way through it. And then this is the overall counter of how many batches we're going through. And then this loss is telling us I think it's the training loss. And then we'll get a validation loss at the end. And we talked a little bit about what these mean. And you'll see this continuously go down, which reflects that the network is learning how to predict characters with a higher amount of accuracy. And the exact loss function being used, I actually don't recall. I think it's a categorical cross entropy, I believe. But in any case, it's not really interpretable. So just as long as it's going down, you know you're doing the right thing. So this is going to go on for a while. And as it goes, it's going to every 1,000 of these. And you can see that we're up to about 150 right now. It's going to create a checkpoint. And actually, these are all old. I'm going to remove those in a second. They're old. So this you'll start seeing them under Bible. And it's going to have a JSON and a T7 file. I'll get into what those mean just a bit later. So since this is going to take a really long time to train, I'm going to go ahead and pause this video lecture and come back to it tomorrow after it has hopefully finished training. And then we can see what we have and begin to work with it again. Okay, and we're now back. It's now Sunday morning, so it was Thursday night when we left off, and the training is done. It didn't actually take 2.5 days. It took only around 30 hours or so, and actually it could take much less because I think at some point the error stopped diminishing by a significant amount, but in any case, we're going to evaluate the results. So I'm going to go back into the ML4A folder at the torch-rnn. We go to the checkpoints folder, CV, and you'll see there's all these Bible.json and Bible.t7 files. The T7 files are models, and they've been saved at every thousand samples. And I think the largest one that we have, or the last one that was made, is 213,000. There we go, 213,000. So this is the one that we're going to start with, because in theory it should be the most accurate one. Again, if you babysit the training process, you could probably stop it much sooner than we did, because the error might stop diminishing, and once it stops diminishing, you probably have as good as possible of a model that you're going to get. Another thing I should mention before we move on, make sure you use the Linux command df to check the available space. I was just at about 100% capacity when I checked it this morning, and so I realized I think almost ran out of hard disk space. If you do, you might get locked out of the terminal, so just make sure that you keep monitoring this, and you can always actually make it bigger by clicking on CPU and disk and changing this to have 20 gigabytes or so, and then saving the changes. So let's try sampling. This is very exciting because this is kind of what we came to do. Let's go into the ML4A folder to torch-rnn, and let's just look really quickly at the instructions for the sampling script. you see that it asks for a checkpoint. So we're just going to take the first one, or I'm sorry, the last one. So th sample checkpoint is going to be in the CV directory. It's going to be Bible213000.t7. And also just recall that we need to turn off the GPU, otherwise it will crash. The other parameters I'll mention briefly, and then we'll maybe experiment with them a little bit. For the length, that's explanatory, so that's the number of characters that we want to produce, so it'll be 2,000 by default. And then start text is that you can actually seed it with an initial text and then condition the RNN on that. We're going to take a look at that in just a second as well. Sampling and temperature I'll explain in just a moment. Let's just try and see what happens when we do this. So we run it and we get a whole bunch of Bible script and we can kind of read it. Blessed there confidently watched away, and that he had made saved whither though blesses by the house of Israel. Dead pillars that he was astonied. 6:14, so the sanctuary of the horses over David's father accompanied this. So it's pretty humorous, and actually this is probably not as good of a job as we can do. If you go, there's a Twitter RNN bot that I think, RNN Bible, that you can look, that has done the same thing, and you can tell it's probably a bit better. So you might want to experiment with having a larger network or a more complicated network with more neurons or more layers to get better results. So now I'm going to evaluate some of these other options that we have. So the sampling flag, what that basically does is it says if you turn sampling off, it's on by default. If you turn it off, it will simply predict the next character, which is the most probable that's from being predicted at every time step. So that isn't super interesting. It'll probably just give us really repetitive results. So let's take a look and see what it does. Yeah, it just does this. So this is kind of just giving us whatever the next most probable character is, and so it tends to get stuck in these loops and kind of becomes very predictable and very repetitive. So that could be interesting in some ways if combined with start texts, which we might want to chat about. But let's also now talk about temperature. We'll keep the sampling on, which it is by default. And temperature is a parameter that also is related to what we were just looking at. So when the temperature is really low, it's 1 by default, right? So, and the temperature essentially is this value, is this parameter which affects the trade-off between how predictable and repetitive we want our text to be and how noisy or random we want it to be. We'll see that there's kind of a trade-off between these. If we make the temperature really low, like let's say 0.05, you'll see that what we have done is we're forcing the network to, it's very simple to turning off sampling. We make the network biased towards the most probable characters, so it will almost always pick the most probable character, and you see that we'll get these long sort of strings from the Bible that just begin looping. And actually you can't make this too low because the number of tokens that you have has to be able to see, yeah, it says invalid multinomial distribution, sum of probabilities is less than zero. So I think this should be less than one actually. But basically, for the number of tokens we have, that times the temperature has to be at least one. So I think in this case, it's around 0.03 is the minimum, and that will do effectively the same thing as turning off sampling. If we make the temperature really high, let's say 1,000, you'll see that it just produces junk. And the reason is that what we've done is by making temperature really high, we make the probability distribution more flat. So we kind of get rid of everything that we've learned, essentially. Usually one is pretty good, and that kind of produces the kind of text that we just saw. If you want it to be a little more random, you can maybe think about using small value. No, actually, that does quite. Maybe 1.5. You may not notice too much of a difference. Your results will vary. But this is something for you to play with, basically. The other thing that you might want to do is the seed text. So again, if we go back to the help file, there's an option for a start text. What this means is that we force the text to begin with something, and then it will predict from there. So if we go start text, and we go hello Jerusalem, it will start with this. If we go back up here, hello Jerusalem, he sat it again and his judgments in the field. So it seeds the text, and it runs these characters through the network, and it conditions the recurrent neural network to start with this. So this is kind of useful for various things. If you want to set up something a little more involved than just making text, you can think about doing something like a chatbot, which is responding to certain commands. You know, maybe you can invert questions to create a chatbot, or maybe you want the network to talk about different topics. So those are all things that are available to you. I was just thinking that it could be interesting to combine this with sampling, turning off sampling. So let's see what happens if we make hello Jerusalem the most probable. Okay, so it gets back to what it was pretty quickly. But there's probably something to this that we might be able to, maybe by having a fairly low temperature, we might be kind of tweaking the network to produce whatever is most likely to come from hello Jerusalem. Or maybe we can, there's a lot of different ways that you can experiment with this. Mm-hmm. One other thing I want to mention is that you can also, so you can just copy all this text and then just put it into a notepad file if you'd like. Or you can actually directly deposit it into a file using this command. So you'll use the right arrow here and then just name the file whatever text file that you want. So bible.txt. So I run this, it'll produce that that string. Go back to the torch-rnn folder, which is where we are, and you'll see that bible.txt is right here. And it produced all the text. So this is a nice, neat way of automatically putting this stuff in the text files. And then you can download them by just right-clicking on them and click download. And now we have bible.txt on the computer. Okay, so that's basically torch-rnn. In class, I'll mention a few different things about it, and maybe do another run-through, and we can talk about different ideas, different things that it can be trained on. Remember that you're not limited to just training on books or things of any obvious nature like that. There's lots of different sources, resources that might, or lots of different kinds of data that can be represented as text, which are super interesting. I just saw yesterday there was someone's been working on making an RNN that predicts choreography, so I'll maybe show that in class. Okay, the next thing I want to do is I want to quickly introduce neural style. Neural style is the other major sort of program that we have in this folder, and it does style transfer. So I'm just going to exit this and make a new terminal and go to the ml4a folder and then into neural style. And there's basically just one script in neural style, which is the neural style script, neuralstyle.lua. Let's look at the help file. And you'll see that this has a bunch of different options. There's only a few that are really required, though. So we need to specify a style image and the content image. And recall that the goal of the neural style process is to combine the content image and the style image into a single image that has the said elements of both. And then there's a bunch of different options that we can play with, and I'm going to describe them in just a moment, but let's start the process by first picking two images So actually, if we go into this folder, images, this is, I made a folder that we can place our images. We don't have anything in here. So I'm going to use these two images that I found, Kandinsky and Liechtenstein. So if we upload this, and remember we can just upload these images directly this way by just placing them in here. So now we have them. We can see them inside the browser. So this is Kandinsky and this is Roy Liechtenstein. So we're going to use the Kandinsky as the content and the Liechtenstein as the style. So we go th neural style content image. It's going to be in the images folder and it's Kandinsky. And then the style image is going to be images Liechtenstein. I haven't done this one before, so I don't know if it's going to turn out good. This is kind of part of the experimental process. If we look at some of these other parameters, let's talk about some of them really quickly. So that's the content image and the style image. One is that there's an optional output image, which will let you name the file. So like if I want to, by default, it'll just go into the neural style home directory. But you can have it instead go to, let's say, into this images folder with the other ones, and we'll call it, Kandinsky Liechtenstein.jpg. And recall that we also do have to turn off the GPU for this because we don't have it. And actually, that's a big downside for neural style right now, is that we don't have the GPU set up, and so this is actually going to take a really long time. It's going to take several hours, I believe, because with the GPU, it goes pretty quickly, about 15 minutes. But the speed up for neural style is quite a bit more, is much larger than the one for torch-rnn, so this is kind of maybe something that we'll have to talk about, figure out how to make this a little more manageable. But in any case, these are the minimum parameters that you need to start the neural style process. Before I do, I just want to mention a few of these other parameters. So the content weight and the style weight, these are, recall from the slides that we talked when we talked about style transfer, there's a trade-off between how much we want the output image to favor reconstructing the style and versus reconstructing the content. And those things are in mutual conflict. These are the defaults. You can think about maybe inverting them if you want to favor the content much more closely. And so they should be pretty self-explanatory. You probably don't have to worry too much about this TV weight. It's a regularization term that is kind of useful for preventing overfitting and also getting rid of some noisy artifacts. But I haven't really needed to use this too much. If you get weird noisy parts in your image, let me know and we can maybe talk about what this TV noise how it's able to counter that. Num iterations, okay, so this is important. So this is how many iterations that the style transfer process takes to finish. 1,000 is a pretty good baseline and I kind of just use that as a default. You'll see that like even by 300 or 400 iterations that the image mostly looks like it's going to look, and so there's this sort of diminishing return for each iteration, and that's kind of important. If you're in a time hurry, you might want to kind of do these at a smaller number of iterations first and do a whole bunch of them, because seeing it at 300 or 400 iterations should give you a pretty good idea of what it's going to look like, and then the other 700 or however many that you set up are kind of just going to more or less perfect it. Or just converge on the logical extreme of whatever it is that you're creating at that moment. Don't worry about normalized gradients. That's part of training parameters that we probably don't need to worry too much about. This is an interesting parameter, and I haven't experimented with it too much. So the process of creating a neural style image will actually start with the content. It will start with a random image by default. So it'll produce a random image of white noise and then begin to change the pixels into the output image that we want. you can actually instead choose to start with the content image. So if you set this flag to be image, then instead of starting with white noise, it'll start with the content image. I found that with the neural style, this doesn't look as good, but it does show much more fidelity towards the content image. And if that's something that you need, that might be important. Don't worry about the optimizer flag. Learning rate is kind of controls the speed at which the learning occurs. And also, I would suggest not really playing with this too much because it's been set up more or less to be optimal for this neural style process, I would say. This specifies that it's going to save an image automatically every 100 iterations. So if we do 1,000 of these, we'll get 10 images of the process. I would make this lower if you want to see the process at each iteration. One iteration, you'll see very little difference. They start to add up eventually after 10, 20, 50, 100 iterations. We'll just keep it at 100 by default and see the images as they're produced every 100 iterations. And the others, pooling, we can use max or average pooling. I think max is usually preferred. These don't have to worry. These are more or less our only options. And the backend, again, this doesn't, for us, we only have one option anyway because there's no GPU, so just NN. And these will be, if you get really into the style transfer process and you want to experiment, this might be actually quite consequential. So this is kind of setting up the optimization, which layers it wants to care about. So for the style layers, it takes all of the ReLU layers, which are the layers that come directly after the convolutional layers. So these are the activation functions at each of the, I think, the convolutional layers. If we change it to highlight other layers, we might get a little bit different character that is more trying to optimize different layers instead of the ones that we specified. And with content, it's pretty interesting. It's set to only care about one of the layers. And that's something that you may want to toy with as well. I think people generally just care about one of the layers, but your results will vary. So let's run this. I'm going to go ahead and click enter. And it will not do anything for a little while because it takes a while to just load the network into memory and begin the process of training. Let me just describe what you should be expecting to happen. So you might get some warnings about, but you probably shouldn't worry about that. So it just loaded the cafe model. So that's the actual network. Now it just loaded the network into memory. So here's its structure. It's a whole bunch of convolutional layers and a few fully connected layers at the end. And these are their sizes. Now it's setting up the style layers. It's going to begin doing the optimization process basically now. So this is going to, like with torch-rnn, this is going to take a long time, especially because we have the GPU off. It's going to take probably a few hours to create this image. So I'm just going to go ahead and let it run its course, and then I'll come back to this video. Let's go ahead and pause, and I'll see you in a few hours. Okay, so let's look at the result. So this is the result of mixing up Kandinsky and Lichtenstein, and we can take a look at the original images. So this is the content image, and this is the style. So the Lichtenstein being applied to Kandinsky. This is like a little abstract, I guess, because we took a kind of abstract painting. If you use content images that are a little more explicit, then you might see a little bit more of the content present in there, but this one's a little bit abstract. Just a few things to note about this. So it took like around 5 hours or so to finish computing, so that's pretty painful in terms of style transfer, and it's because we don't have GPU support in this terminal instance. With GPU support, that same image would have taken only like 15 minutes or so. So obviously you can do this a lot faster and therefore do it on a lot more images with GPU support. So we'll talk about in the next class how to maybe set that up. For now, we can kind of at least take a couple of, there's a couple of tricks we can use to maybe make it a little easier for us to prototype. So one thing you can observe is that this is what it looks like after 500 of the 1,000 iterations. So you see that it looks actually pretty, it resembles very much the already what the final product is going to look like. And so you don't have to necessarily go all the way to get a good expectation of what the output image is going to look like. So you can even maybe get a good sense of it from just 300 iterations. So if you want to try a whole bunch of them quickly, I would just just run these not entirely all the way, and then you can try a bunch out and then do a final render in one that you want to put more compute time into. Another thing that you can do to make this take a little bit less time is, let's look at the help file. The size of the image is basically this guarantees that either the height nor the width is more than this size, and by default it's 512 pixels. You can't really do more than this because it requires too much memory to hold all of the data that it has to. You can try a little bit bigger, but you might run out of memory. So 512 is kind of the max that we've been using, but this also makes it take a lot longer. So if you set image size to be like 512, so let's say we were doing this, and then we could just do image size to some smaller number, so let's say like 256. So this would make the image 1/4 the size, right? Because we're reducing the resolution on both the X and the Y axis by half, from 512 to 256, and so the amount of computation will also go down by that much, and so it'll take roughly 1/4 the time that this took. So combined with reducing the number of iterations and making a smaller image, you can cut down on the computation a lot, maybe by like 10 times or more. And so you can use this if you want to cut some corners. You can kind of produce you can try a whole bunch of these. You can maybe make a bash script which has a lot of the images that you want to try. And then one that you like, you can try to make a bigger one down the road. So those are all things that you can try. In next class, we'll look at a few more different code bases and different environments that we can run some of these deep learning experiments, and actually take a survey sort of the deep learning landscape more generally, and talk about some of the alternatives to both terminal and how to maybe install this software in other environments. So, okay, that's all.